it's Mother's Day. And we honor all the ladies because not every lady can have a child. But every lady has impacted so many people and shaped a lot of people into the awesome people that they are today. So we honor all the ladies in the house today. And as I prayed about how to make Mother's Day special at MCOG, I want you to know that God heard my prayer. He answered my prayer this way. You see, today is going to be really special. It's a once-in-a-lifetime thing because my son Micah is going to tag in with me. All right? For those of you that don't know him, he's a student at Liberty University pursuing pastoral studies. He's going to be a senior and earn his degree in 3 years instead of four. In just a few weeks, he'll be traveling to a really large church in Connecticut to be doing an internship there. I think we've got 70 people on staff and 4 campuses and all that. So, but I kind of warned him up a while ago and said, hey, Dad's got an idea. And then he got home and I said, oh, I've got an idea for you. And so he spent a lot of time in prayer this week. And it's all good. But what we want to do together is we want to share with you an amazing story. I thought I said, look, all I know about the assignment is we got to find a lady who's doing the Bible. We got to learn from this lady in the Bible, whoever it is. And so I let the Spirit of the Lord move upon him. So there's an anointing on his life. There's gifts and talents in his life. There's a call in his life. And I recognize that. That's what his son telling me. What are we looking at? And he said, Dad, we need to tell the amazing story of the unfailing love that we see as we look at the life of Ruth. Let's go there. So we're going to take a look at Ruth, and we're just going to take a look at the story of unfailing love. And what I want to do is I want to pray, and then as soon as I get done praying, Michael is going to come up here. He is going to help our hearts and minds as he sets the scene and reads the scripture and explains the scripture a little bit and helps us to understand where the story is taking place. It's going to bless you. Are you ready for unfailing love? Come on, somebody. Are you going? All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, in the strong name of Jesus, I just come to you right now. I know that you have anointed this moment in time, but I also know that you have anointed the weeks and days and moments coming up for right now. And so, Lord, I pray for your anointing to be strong in this text. I pray for the anointing to be strong on my son and in myself. I pray that that anointing that makes preaching fun and smooth and easy to deliver, to be upon us, God. I pray for your revelation and that we would yield to the person of the Holy Spirit as we proclaim your truth today. Now, God, give those who have an ear to hear what the Spirit of God is saying. We welcome those that are online, those that are here for the first time, and those that have been here their entire lifetime. God, I believe you have a word for all of us. But help us, God, to be alert. Help us not to be distracted. Let us receive your word that we might employ your word. Employ your word in our life and experience the truth that is found in your word. We thank you for the unfailing love of our Heavenly Father. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the church says, amen, and amen, and amen. Micah, bring us to the scene, man. Tell us the story. Give us up to speed. All right.
So today we have a beautiful text in Luke full of grace and love, but it's also full of Jewish custom with a lot of deep-seated roots in Levitical law. And we're going to try and do it, I should say, rather quickly. So let's not waste any more time and get right in. So, Ruth chapter 1, verse 1. In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and a man in Bethlehem, in Judah, went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his 2 sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife Naomi, and the names of his 2 sons, Malon and Kilion. They were Ephrathites from Bethlehem in Judah, and they went into the country of Moab and remained there. But Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died, and she was left with her 2 sons. These took Moabite wives, the name of one Orpah and the other Ruth. Quick pause there in case you're like me, who visualizes while you read, but has a hint of dyslexia. That is Orpah, not Oprah, because that, at least for me, severely will throw off the meaning of the text. Let's continue. It will. I mean, most of you are laughing. There's someone out there going, yes, okay, I got you. I'm really going to keep moving. All right. And both Malon and Kilion died, so that the woman was left without her 2 sons and her husband. All right, that was a lot. And that's going to set up the whole rest of the text and prepare us. So let's circle back and walk through that a little bit. in the days when the judges rule. What does this exactly mean? In the days of the judges, it's a book right not long before this, and it has people such as Deborah and Samson, but this was a dark time in Israel, a lot of sin and a lack of commitment to the law of the Lord that was marked by the statement throughout the book of Deuteronomy, every man did what is right in his own eyes, and you even get to see that literally immediately here with the family that our author is highlighting. First off, why is there a famine in the land at all? They are in the promised land in Bethlehem in Judah. And so in Deuteronomy 11, the Lord states that this would be a land of prosperity as long as the country of Israel is faithful to his command. So right off the bat, we have unfaithfulness, and then it seeps into the family we are looking at. Elimelech, the head of the house, takes his family out of Judah, the promised land, and quite literally takes backward steps against what his ancestors did not all that long ago and takes them into a pagan land of Moab. And then he dies. And now we turn to the chief son, who again, similar to their father, go directly against the word of God and take Moabite wives. This was instructed for them not to do, to take wives of pagan land around them. So then they die as well, and now we see Naomi, Orpah, and Ruth left in one of the worst spots to be at in ancient Israel culture, especially Naomi. They are without, essentially, at that time, provision or protection, and now are going to be forced to live off the generosity of others for the rest of their time. And so let's continue on. Now that we have these women in a very vulnerable position in verses 6 and 7. Then she arose with her daughters-in-law to return from the country of Moab, which she had heard in the fields of Moab, that the Lord had visited his people and given them food. So she set out from the place where she was with her two daughters-in-law, and they went on the way to return to the land of Judah. And this is where we're going to get our first glimpse of the unfailing love of God. This is a time, as I said, where every man did what is right in his own eyes. They were an unfaithful people to the Lord. But out of his unfailing love, they relieved them of the famine. And now we have these women out of desperation, because for Naomi, what is she going to do in a pagan land with no family, where she has to live off the generosity? So now we get to move into Bethlehem, and they're going to go on this journey. And now we're going to start to see, as the story of Ruth shows us, the power of God's love working in us and through us. But we first need to recognize this. When hard times or tragedies come, watch out for the times when you are wrestling with bitterness, as we are about to see Naomi do next. So let's continue on in verse 8. But Naomi said to her daughters-in-law, "Go, return each of you to your mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you, if you have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant that you may find rest, each of you and your house with your husband." Then she kissed them, and they lifted up her voices and wept. And they said to her, "No, we will return with you and your people." Now what we are seeing here from Naomi, telling them to go away from her, to stay in their land, is rather logical for someone at that time. But I found, at least in my short life so far, that God seems to not work in the ways that we as sinful humans find logical. And so what we're seeing here, Jason, where he is a horizontal focus. And what I mean by that is she is completely wrapped up in her circumstances around her, and not at all do we see her consult the Lord on what may be provided to her. So she completely misses the fact that although her family was unfaithful, she is now left with two daughters-in-law who can provide her companionship, and as we'll see later on throughout the book, Ruth end up providing her help for provision. But she even misses something bigger. As I said before, this is a pagan land she is in, with pagan wives that she is dealing with, and she has the opportunity to bring them into the promised land, to bring them to know the true God of Israel, Yahweh. But she fails to see that because she does not have a vertical focus at all. She is completely wrapped up in her own situation, which is very difficult at the time. So now we're going to keep going in verse 11. But Naomi said, "Turn back, my daughter. Why will you go with me? Have I yet sons in my womb that they may become your husbands? Turn back, my daughter. Go your way. for I am too old to have a husband. If I still say that I have hope, even if I should have a husband this month, which would bear sons, would you therefore wait till they were grown? Would you therefore refrain from men? No, my daughter, so it is exceedingly bitter to me for your sake that the hand of the Lord has gone out against you. Now, it's that latter half of verse 13 that reveals so much to us, so let's do it again. The hand of the Lord has gone out against me. Naomi has completely become in a state of feeling abandoned by the Lord, and even here we're seeing that she is starting to panic on God, that we have Naomi's birth completely revealed to us. And now we're going to start to learn that it is vital that we watch out for and pray that the root of bitterness does not take hold into our lives. And now God is going to come back up and show us what that may look like.
That is so awesome. I love this point, right?
Yeah.
I love how Micah just shared with us that we need to have a vertical focus and not a horizontal focus. Horizontal is this world and the things around us that are temporary. Vertical is forever. It's with God, it's with Christ, right? And so I know even Frank Pastor Jason, because I use a student ministry called Vertical Student Ministry, Vertical Youth. So we're going to plug to him and thank you for all you're doing behind the scenes today, Pastor Jason. So I want to echo what he just said because it's so important. It is vital. Absolutely vital that we recognize and watch out for and pray that the root of bitterness does not take hold in our lives during times of tragedy and hard times and unexpected things that can happen to us. And listen, the root of bitterness leads to fruit that will bring you down and keep you in a mindset that is far from Christ. Because what I want you to understand about the root of bitterness, it's a lot like some large trees. Have you ever heard, or maybe you've had the experience, you had a large tree in your yard, and you didn't realize that the root system, there were so many roots, and they went so deep and so far, and sometimes those roots can actually wrap around a water supply to your house, or the water going out, the wastewater going out of your house, and you find out you've got to go and dig and do all this work, and it really messes up your life, and messes up your yard. Have you ever had that experience before? Maybe you know what I'm talking about. Maybe you know somebody. That's not fun. Well, in the same way, the root of bitterness, if we don't watch out for it, it's got all kind of root systems, if you will, that will wrap around us. It'll wrap around our relationships. It'll wrap around our work life. It'll wrap around our recreational life. It'll wrap around our marriage. It'll wrap around our finances. It'll wrap around our emotional health. And it will squeeze the life out of us and take us to a place that is far from God. And it leads to us experiencing all kinds of, I'm just going to call it, freaky fruit. And so I just want to expose to you some things to look out for, some symptoms of this root of bitterness. If we look at the term, I'm not going to go there right now, but if you turn to Hebrews chapter 12, verses 14 and 15, we see the Bible warns us about resentment, and specifically the resentment that Esau experienced. And that was all at the root of bitterness for selling his birthright for just a bowl of beans. It's crazy. Ephesians 4 and 31 indicates that this fruit that can happen, that can spring out of bitterness, is rage and anger. But Ephesians tells us in 4:31, I do want you to see this, it says, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you. Take you put away. You've got to put away from you, along with all malice. Not just that, here's another negative fruit that comes out of this. It's called hatred. Hatred springs up out of the root of bitterness, and it gets encoded with this wrong self-righteousness even, and it makes you feel justified in your hatred. But 1 John 4 and 20 tells us that if we have hatred in our heart and we claim to have the love of God in us, then that makes us a liar. We are lying about saying that God's in us, that God is love, and God loves me, and I love you. No, you don't. You're a liar. That's what the Word of God says. And so we have to watch out for this. And we know, all we have to do is look around our society today, and we can see the devastation that hatred creates in humanity. It's absolutely horrible. And again, it's one of those, it's like a tentacle where something just comes out from that root of bitterness. You've got to watch out for that. Another thing is depression. Depression is something that is definitely connected to the root of bitterness. And Proverbs 12 and 25 tells us anxiety can really weigh down our heart, right? And in Hebrews, if we go back there again in chapter 3, we can see that it's easy to make the connection that if left untreated long enough, the root of bitterness can actually lead to spiritual blindness. Now, that's a really scary thing. You're like, what does spiritual blindness look like? How about the life of Samson when the anointing of God left him and he didn't even know it? Would that happen to him? That's a form of spiritual blindness. Okay? To have ears but not to hear. To have a form of godliness but to not have power. To receive words but no understanding, no knowledge, no revelation, no application. To believe a falsehood to be a truth and a truth to be a falsehood. To not to be double-minded, unstable, and all those. All these things are consequences of spiritual blindness, which gets itself back to the root of bitterness. So I share these symptoms with you of the root of bitterness because knowing all of this, I think it's easy to understand how Naomi's life and mindset could have gone and stayed down a very dark road for a very long time. She lost everything. That's going to make you sad. That's going to make you go through a ton of emotions that I hope none of us have to go through. But some of you right now, you're going through emotions, you're experiencing different things, and the state of bitterness is knocking at your door. And if you've been wrestling with feelings of bitterness, or if you've been experiencing any of these symptoms of the truth that I've just described to you, I don't want you to feel bad. I don't want you to feel bad about feeling bad. I don't want you to feel condemned about that. I want you to understand, I want to take a deep breath in, chill. Okay, because I've got really good news for you. Naomi experienced a massive pivot point in her life, a massive change in her heart, a massive change in her life. And the good news is, you can also. You can experience a massive pivot, a massive change in point. You don't talk about pivot like you're going this way. What? Going this way, man. How many of you ever experienced something in life where all of a sudden your course just changes dramatically? How many of you would like your life just to change dramatically? You don't, nobody really got the root of bitterness right from. They usually don't like it. I mean, you might ask them, do you want to get better? No, I want to get better. You know what I mean? And they, you know, but usually they're like, no, I'm just down and out. No, I don't want it. I don't want to be. I just want to be right where I am right now. I'm miserable and I want to stay with you. Well, God's life is just too short for that. Allow God to do something in you. It's just extraordinary. And so I want you to know that everything can change in your heart and in your mind today. Did you hear me? I said today. It can happen for you today. Because I want you to understand this. It's absolutely amazing how powerful love can be. And I'm really talking about the love of God. And so this amazing power of love. To begin sharing that a little bit, I'm going to ask Micah to come back up here. I think he's going to start with verse 14. And he's going to share some spiritual truth with us about how powerful love can be.
All right. So let's go right back in to verse 14. Then they lifted up their voices, after she said to go away from him. Then they lifted up her voices and wept again. And Orpah kissed him, mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to him. So here we see Orpah is following the direction of Naomi, and she's going back home. But Ruth is clinging to this, so that she's clinging to it. Now, it's important to focus in on that word clung because I think it's used intentionally by the original author. In the original Hebrew, this is a word that can also mean, or better mean, to be joined together. This is the same word used back in Genesis 2:24 to describe a marriage between a man and woman in the commitment to their union. Also used a number of times in Deuteronomy to describe the Israelite commitment that they were supposed to have to God and His ways. Ruth clung to her in an amazing fashion. And she said, see, this being Naomi, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her God. Return after your sister-in-law. But Ruth said, do not urge me to leave you or to return from following you, for where you go, I will go. And where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord do so to me, and more also, if anything but death parts me from you. Now, here we are seeing powerful love at work through God in Ruth towards Naomi. Ruth commits to her. She clings. Ruth was willing, in this moment, to forsake everything she knew, everything she had. And this she is saying, I'm going to leave my family, I'm going to leave my friends, I'm going to leave my place that I've lived my whole life. I'm even willing to leave my belief that she says your God will be my God. She is committing to her to death, and even somehow past death, I will be buried wherever you are buried. Ruth is committing to her and giving this outpouring of powerful love. The Lord provided in me Naomi with a daughter-in-law who is completely committed to her powerful love.
This incredible act of love and commitment by Ruth changed Naomi's life. Now, I'm going to give you a sneak peek into some of those changes, but there's a process. It didn't happen instantaneously for her, and we can learn from that. But I just want you to know that this incredible act of love, it really changed her life. Her heart received the antidote to bitterness. And the antidote is love. The love of God is the antidote that's the cure. You can be dealing with bitterness for a decade, and if you'll just let love do its job, I'm telling you, in just a moment, everything can change for you. It's just absolutely incredible. You don't have to go down the road she did, but anyway, let me just tell you that she thought her life was over, but God, somebody say, but God. But God had a new beginning for her. This pivot point in her life brought her on a path that would lead to two great things being restored. Micah talked about it earlier. He talked about how she lost her protection and she lost her provision. But because of this incredible, unfailing act of love, this incredible act of love, this tremendous commitment, all of a sudden those things are restored to her, protection, provision, so much more. It's absolutely amazing how powerful love can be. So let me just ask a question. What might happen if we, who claim to have the love of God in us, decided to love bitter people? What if we determined in our hearts that we are going to love difficult people? Anybody can love people that are easy to love. Even people without God can do that. But we have the power of Christ in us through the Holy Spirit. There's supposed to be something distinguishingly different about us. We're peculiar people. That doesn't mean that we're like weird freaks. But it means that we should be able to prayerfully make an impact in the lives of difficult people around us. And sometimes I think God places difficult people around us for a season to help us to grow, to help us to mature, but also because I think the Holy Spirit is waiting for us to answer the question, yes, I will love that difficult person. And love can come in all kinds of practical words, deeds, and actions, and it all begins with a posture of prayer, saying, God, help me. I receive your love. Let me share your love. You know, another question. Can you think of a time in your life when maybe you were bitter or maybe you were difficult? Look this way, maybe you were difficult. People aren't going to look at it. But you experienced a change, a pivot point, because somebody was deeply committed to you. Somebody loved you through the darkness. Come on, just raise your hand the past if you've ever experienced that, right? How does it feel? It felt awesome, didn't it? It felt absolutely, it was like, this feels so great, let's feel great, we've got to celebrate. Praise God. Go wherever you like to go to celebrate. Grab your title, whatever works for you. Two food references. That's what I'll give you today. Those of you here for the first time, I have a chance to talk about food. I'm sorry, I don't eat a lot on Sundays. I pray a lot. Don't eat a lot. Before church. You know, when I reflect on moments in my life, I can see often that the act of love and the act of the commitment being kept, loving me when I was difficult, loving me when I was wrestling with bitterness, was the beginning of a bunch of dominoes in my life. You know, a domino, I can take a look at a trajectory and a change and all kinds of positive possibilities became a reality in my life. And I can often trace that back to a moment in time when someone just loved Andy when he was difficult, when he was bitter, when he was wrestling with something. And they just loved me through that moment. And I thank God. I think we need to be those kind of people for our living world, don't you? But, you know, obviously the ultimate example of this is Jesus Christ. I mean, this whole thing is a portrait of our great Redeemer, Jesus Christ. And it's just incredible. He gave us the ultimate example of giving and releasing the power of life. God so loved the world that he was going to be our son. And then Jesus prayed in the garden, said, not my will, but thy will be done, and freely gave it up. He gave up his life. And
God has raised for us and intercedes for us and prays for us. He sent the Holy Spirit to give us. It's absolutely incredible. You see, Noah, can't say it. Naomi, thank you. Experienced the amazing power of love because she allowed love into her life. This was a challenge for her. And I propose that sometimes it's a challenge for us to allow love into our life. We become guarded and gated and masked. And we put up our boots and we're not letting you in. And today, I want to encourage you. Take the mask off. Relax. Learn from Naomi. Allow love in. Because listen, allowing love into our lives can change our perspective. That's what she really needed. She needed a perspective change. And it can allow us to experience a future that's beyond our wildest dreams. You see, so often life doesn't change, but our perspective does. Can you think of times in your life when things didn't change, the mortgage didn't change? Work didn't change, your boss didn't change, the program didn't change, but your attitude changed, your perspective changed. And in that moment, as soon as your perspective changed, you became victorious in Christ. All of a sudden, then you're like, aha, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I am more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. All of a sudden, you muster up all kinds of supernatural strength on the inside because the perspective changes. Oftentimes, what we need to see that kind of shift is the same thing she needed. Which was seeing to learn how to let love into her life. It was a challenge for her, and Mike is going to tell us about his challenge, and also how she eventually allowed love into her life.
Yeah. So now, after this happened, after this pure outpouring of love by Ruth to Naomi, we get sort of a bad example on how not to accept love. So let's read about what not to do, but given us by Naomi. And when Naomi saw that she was determined to go with her, she said no more. Now let's just kind of stop. We just have a tremendous outpouring of love by Ruth that is nothing short of a blessing from God, and as we'll see in the later chapters, a setup for provision. And Naomi's decision is nothing. I don't think this was because the author got bored or ran out of things. I think this was purposeful that he tells us that she just simply said nothing. It's kind of a little whatever, fine, come with me moment to me. How many of us have seen the original, despicable me? Okay, good amount, not as many. Happy Mother's Day. Go watch it when you get home. Okay? So in that, Gru, the main character, while he is young, has this infatuation with rockets. And so he also has a need for his mother's approval. We want some kind of acknowledgement from him. And so he paints a picture of a rocket, and then he makes a macaroni model of a rocket. Neither of them seem to get much out of his mother. Maybe he's just a hard woman to impress. Who knows? But then he builds a rocket. On a small scale, he puts in the backyard, brings his mom out, he sets up, he's excited, it takes off in spectacular fashion. He's got to be thinking, oh my God, it turns around, and his mom goes, and you tell them how that feels to me here. So, I mean, just Ruth, as we'll see here in a second, is really taking this stuff on the chin and just keeps moving. And I think that's through the unfailing love of God. So, and then after this happens, somehow Ruth decides to stay with him. But, you know, maybe she's a little so, I'm going to keep going. So we keep moving. And then they decide to return to Bethlehem in Judah. And when they get back, it's been about 10 to 11 years since they've been gone. And they get back, and the people who would have known as just a small village, everyone knows everyone. So she comes back with Ruth by her side. They go, is this Naomi? Her name, Naomi, meaning pleasant. Is this pleasant? Wouldn't we all like to be pleasant? Wouldn't it be nice? As we get back and we go around places, it's pleasant. And no, she says, instead, let's read it. Do not call me Naomi. Call me Mara. What this means, Mara means bitter. So as they come up with pleasant, she goes, don't call me pleasant. Call me bitter. And then we start to see why.
She says, "For the Lord Almighty has dealt very bitterly. I went away full, and the Lord brought me back empty. Why call me Naomi? Why call me pleasant? When the Lord has testified against me, and the Almighty has brought calamity upon me." Now, in this passage, we had our heart revealed not long ago. And now we see the root of bitterness has become her complete identity. Now, this is similar to another story. The woman with the issue of blood. What is her name? Everybody together? We have no idea, because her identity became her ailment. And the same thing is happening here on a different scale, because her perspective and not allowing that makes this her identity. Bitterness becomes her identity. And not only that, but she is blaming the Lord for her bitterness. The Lord brought me back to you. Not seeing her family's unfaithfulness or her Israel's unfaithfulness. I was brought back empty. He took everything from me. Also, a small act to Ruth is standing right now. Her first off, she doesn't care about her giant outpouring of love. And she goes, "He brought me back empty. He brought me back empty." This is right there. She's a tough woman. She keeps on going with it. And now, that's the end of chapter 1. So let's go through 2 and 4. And before anyone panics, cancels another big plan. We're not going to go through it like we went through this. Instead, let's just summarize through it. So in chapter 2, we see that Ruth now takes on the role of her having to live off the generosity of others to provide the food for them. And by doing this, she goes out into the field, which was custom at the time for people such as Naomi and Ruth, whether fatherless, poor, or foreigner, or widow. Allowed to go into the field of another. And in this process, she starts to glean from the field and she meets Boaz, who is a relative of Elimelech, Naomi's past husband. And he's a great man of wealth in the region. And as she gleans from the field, Boaz and Ruth are kind to each other, an exchange of trust occurs. And then we see throughout this process in chapter 2 of the hard work by Ruth. And she has now committed her life to following and trusting the God of Israel. The unfailing love has come into her own life and accepted her actions. And then in chapter 2, we see our first shift in Naomi herself, and it's down in verse 20. And Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, after Ruth came back and reported to her of all the good things happening, "May he be blessed by the Lord, whose kindness has not forsaken the living or the dead. Finally, bitter as she has claimed herself a woman, this woman of bitterness has started to go back to her former self of Naomi, of pleasantness. She is seeing that love is working in her life and starting to allow it in there." And then in that verse, we also see that this man, Elimelech, is a redeemer of the city. Now, what on earth does that mean to be a redeemer? We don't really have anything like this in our culture today. To be a redeemer was to have many different responsibilities if you're in the family line of another. And one of them was to give a child to the widow and to marry her. And so we see that this process now starts to take place. Elimelech is a redeemer who is capable to perpetuate the family name. Boaz, thank you. You get it. That would be hard. So Boaz. Boaz is the redeemer for the family, but that doesn't happen yet. The butterflies of love are not yet flying. And then as chapter 3 goes on, there's more time. The two start to spend time around each other, Ruth and Boaz. They get to know each other as she goes to the field. And Naomi sees this and tells her to approach Boaz for marriage. Let's move with this redeemer. He is a great man. He is kind to you. You're building a relationship. Naomi is starting to now work for herself in the world. And so they go on. Ruth approaches Boaz. And the process starts to take place of perpetuating the name. And then we get into chapter 4. Actually, right before that, we also see Naomi's perspective number 2 is changing. As she says, "Wait for him. He's calming Ruth down. Wait for him. Boaz will take care of it. He has dealt with, we will take care of it today. And then now we're in chapter 4. Boaz, we also see, is completely committed to following the commands and the law of the Lord. As he goes through the correct process of taking this role as the leader, that there is one closer to him in relationship to him. Yes, still in life. And so this goes on, and then finally, essentially, we don't have time. The other redeemer says, no. And then both, like, yay. That's the short version, Michael version, write that down in your Bible. And then all of it is starting to come together. And then Boaz and Ruth are met. Now, what a complete change from 2 chapters ago. Naomi tried to be alone, tried to push everyone out of her completely horizontal focus. Now, a vertical focus, and God has blessed her with a daughter in law who is committed and loved. And Boaz, the redeemer, has stepped into this world and is married, and now things are starting to come together.
Where are you going? What do you have to ask?
Come on, right there. Tag it.
Woo!
Yeah. It's so awesome. Isn't it great that she finally allowed God's love into her life, and that also changed absolutely everything?
So I think the challenge for us is if we've been wrestling with bitterness, and now we realize this amazing love has just got this incredible power, it's unfailing.
When we begin to see the potential of love entering into our life, or commitment entering into our life, maybe we should not be like the Midian's mom. And go, hey, just saying, maybe we could skip some of that, maybe we don't have to change our name, my name now is misery and despair, and woe is me, and stuff and so forth. But maybe instead we would say, okay. And just instead of going like this, go like this, maybe you just go like this. And you let love in. If you've been wrestling with bitterness, if you've been feeling like you've lost everything, if you feel like life is absolutely hopeless, I want you to mentally, emotionally, spiritually, I want you to go like this. And that's just a feeling, just be honest. It's awkward. But this is how we receive. You can't receive something. But what if God, if he could just even tell me, if God's good to me, God's comforting me, but if this is good for you. But I want you to consider and ask yourself, have you allowed love into your life? And the greatest love is Jesus Christ. And so that's the first and most important question. Have you allowed the love of God into your life by accepting the redeeming work of Jesus Christ, who can absolutely change everything? Every change, everything changed for Naomi's life and for Ruth's life. Everything changed for their lives when love got on the scene. Love has already been on the scene 2,000 years ago. The question is, what have you done with the message? Today you've heard the message that there is a God who loves you. And the Bible says if you believe in your heart that Christ died for you and lived for you, if you believe he was raised from the dead, if you believe that you call upon him and he'll forgive you, he says, thus, if you believe these things in your heart, confess these things in your mouth, you shall be saved. And that is the beginning point for everybody in Christ. For every Christian, for every follower of Christ, we all start at the same point. We say, I'm going to let love in. I need some forgiveness. And I need healing. I need bitterness to be healed. Or maybe it's anger, or resentment, or depression, or whatever it is, or addiction, whatever it is that's kind of tripping you up. We say, God, here I am, I am perfect, but you are still perfect for someone like me. Come into my life. And so we make confession of Christ through prayer. We just simply verbalize in prayer what we believe in our heart. And the Bible says, then you're going to be saved. There could be others of you today who say, well, you know what, I'm just living far from God. I know what it is to be close to God, and I'm far from God. Today is your day to make a prayer of commitment, and then call your mom, or your spiritual mom, or somebody that's like a lady, and say, hey, today I'm right back with God where I need to be. I was there, and now I'm here. I got real close to God. It's awesome. Allow love to continue to do this work in your life. If you're wrestling with bitterness or whatever else, surrender that today. Your hands are open. Why? Just lay it down. Why carry that heavy, heavy load? Have you ever gone to the airport with like a whole bunch of suitcases? Is anybody else a heavy packer like me? I pack it all. I don't care if it's Walmart. I don't want to go there. I bring it.
And boy, when I get to that curbside check-in, you know I'm feeling good. I'm like, oh, thank you. And it's so good to walk through that airport and have your load light and everyone's looking at it. Right? And so in the same way, lighten your load for that. Just lay it down. Say, God, I'm not feeling this anymore. You love me so much. I'm going to allow love to do its work in me. I'm going to get a name change today. And then for the rest of us, there's no advice. Hey, how about this? Let's go out and be committed to being roots in a world full of people that are wrestling with bitterness. There's a whole lot of people out there that we can affect for positive. And all we've got to do is let our light shine by living a life, by speaking words of kindness and love and acts of kindness and love. It doesn't have to be something radical, but there will be times in life when God will ask us to demonstrate our commitment to someone that we deeply love. Like we do, we need to demonstrate that with love, people through their difficult times. Thank God, He's going to preach with us. Amen? Now it's time for us to go and do it for them. Before we close in prayer, Michael, you've got just a little bit more here, don't you? Just a tiniest bit, and then with our promise, we're going to be done. It really does mean something when I say that today.
So, Boaz and Ruth have just been wed, and now it says that the Lord left them with a child. And who is this child? It is Obed, the father of Jesse, the father of David. So how on earth did this happen? In case you don't know, David held the ancestral line of Christ. So now Ruth and Naomi, widows. Naomi lost everything through the unfailing love of God, has been brought into the ancestral line of Jesus Christ. So how did this happen? God provided Naomi with a loving companion and committed worker in Ruth. God provided the Redeemer in Boaz that gave provision and protection and perpetuated the name of Elimelech. And God was faithful to Naomi even in her unfaithfulness and her family. God saw the faithfulness at work in the lives of Ruth and Boaz and brought them together. And God, all of this has an unfailing love in the story of Ruth that works in the lives of people who don't deserve it, to an unlikely person in the pagan, Moabite widow. How on earth does this relate to us? Like, great, I just got a really cool history lesson. Because what we read is historical. So if you don't like to watch the History Channel for fun, like myself, then what on earth do we do with it? We are people of sin in a fallen world. Like Naomi, we have no hope at all. It's a little bleak, but how do we get through this? We have to have a vertical focus, completely committed to the direction and seeing and allowing the unfailing love of God in our lives. To trust God in all the bitter circumstances that we will encounter in this fallen world. But we don't just have to hope with the vertical focus. God, like He provided Boaz as a Redeemer to Naomi and Ruth, provided us with a Redeemer in Christ Jesus of Nazareth, who came, who lived a life in human flesh, humbled Himself, died the death on the cross that we were supposed to die. And now we have been redeemed through that. We ourselves are a living Naomi every day. And we have to put our faith in Christ and remain in the unfailing love of God. But this is not a simple one-time thing. For me, that was 15 years ago. That wouldn't do me a whole lot of good today. Every day, you must be committed to allowing God into your life. You must be watchful for bitterness in seasons of struggle and trial, like Naomi. Look for the root in your life that God is providing for you as committed companions and workers, and seek the love of Christ. Always. The unfailing love of God will never forsake His people, even though they don't deserve it. So with that, I think we really need to pray. I think we just got to give the thanks to God in prayer. We're going to bless all the ways to pray for you, but we can't do that until we do something with this message. The Bible says, don't be just a hearer, be a doer. So right now, we're going to do it the way that we're going to let love in. And I want you to pray and concentrate with me, because I realize that there are some people here today that
you've never allowed the love of God into your life before. You don't know your past, where you go. But something clicked today for you. Something in your mind, in your heart says, this God is real, Jesus is real, and I need to accept Him into my life. I need to make Him my Lord. I need to ask Him to forgive me my sin. I need Him to come into my life. I need Him to help me with my root of whatever. I need Him to change the trajectory of my life. There could be others today that as we pray this, your prayer is a prayer of recommitment and drawing close to God. You're tired of being far from Him. You know God brought you here on purpose today. This message has been resonating with you. And you're like, I've got to do something. Well, we begin with prayer. So can we just all repeat this prayer? And those of you that really mean this, and this is definitely for you, we're doing this because we just want heaven to hear your prayer today. So we're going to pray in a loud voice together. Amen. And after church, you let us know. So let's pray. Father in heaven, I call upon you to show me mercy, grace, and forgiveness. I confess and I believe that Jesus Christ died for me, rose for me, lived for me, and now He is my Savior. Jesus cleansed me. Forgive me. Draw me close to you. Help me to let go of any bitter root or anything else. Help me to serve you one day at a time. I'm never going to be the same. In Jesus' name.